Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadjia Varney, your host. What do you know about your local school committee? You know, our great American vision of public education for all has as its tradition that citizens will control the schools. Well, what would, with all the changes, what would our current 21st century school committees be like? Well, today, I'm excited to invite two people who have been living and working with school committees. From Massachusetts, the president of the Massachusetts Association of School Committee, Penny Blackwell, and from Rhode Island, the Rhode Island Association of School Committees, Katherine Paternaude. Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for
having us. So glad to have you here again. You know, I've been reading about both of you. I got tired reading all the things that you have been doing. It seems as though you've worked from all kinds of angles with school committees, and now you're the president of the state associations. I'm just kind of wondering, how did you get interested? I mean, they're not paying you big salaries to do this. How did you get interested in working with school committees?
I originally became interested because I was a parent advocate leader in my town anyway. I was a PTA member, became president of the PTA council. And I was telling my constituents, you know, my members, my membership to go to meetings. And so I started going to meetings and I realized, wow, they don't have any citizens' comments at our meetings. And so that was my real, and so when I had asked the chair of the committee if we could have citizens' comments, he was very adamant and said no. And so I said, I know I can get that. I know I believe in grassroots organizations and the power of people. And so I said, you know, if I get elected, I'm going to make sure this happens. And I was successful.
Wonderful. Yeah. And Penny, how did you get interested in?
About the same way. It's pretty funny. I went through the PTA as on the executive committee and up through president and spent an awful lot of nights at school committee meetings reporting about PTA concerns and whatnot to the school committee. We were really lucky that we actually have had in Sandwich an agenda item for PTA reports for about probably 20 years.
Wow.
Which is pretty cool.
So I'll have to think about that.
Yeah.
Sounds like a good item.
Yeah, it is a good item. So we've so I would go and report, and they finally said to me, you know, really, you should just run.
Well, that's what happens. And you go to make a point, and you get hired or fired.
Hijacked.
I kind of decided that I belonged on the other side of the table, that I needed to be on the policy-making side of the table.
And you've done a lot. Both of you have received accolades and awards from your various states. Let's get to be good teachers, and I know, Katherine, you're at Brown and teaching still, and you as a nurse, an administrator, you're teaching. We're all working with people. So we need a definition. So I looked up for a very simple definition of what's a school board or a school committee, and it said the school board sets the vision for the school district, and the decisions they make at their monthly meetings make a difference at each school. Is this, you know, adding in technology and all that goes on, how would you describe briefly or characterize a school committee's work now?
I like what that says, that the school committee sets the vision for the school district. I think that's perfect, and I think we do that through our policy making, through our budgetary process. And I think that as the adults in the room, that we kind of set the tone for how we want this school community to be.
Yeah, I agree. And I think since we represent the people, we're elected, most of us are elected. There are some appointed members of school boards, but I myself am elected. Most of us are elected. Mm-hmm. And so I think as an elected person, you need to be an advocate for your constituents, but also for your students, for your teachers, for your administration. And I think you need that outside sort of objective, hopefully, body to actually look at all sides and not have just one interest and one advocacy position. Mm-hmm. So you can look at all pieces of it and try to come up with good policy for student achievement, because that's really what we're all about, moving our kids forward.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking about policy and achievement, No Child Left Behind has certainly stirred up a lot of debate and discussion. Mm-hmm. And some people say the curriculum's gotten narrowed and it wasted time on test preparation and all that kind of thing. And some people objected to the fact that they would measure a school by looking at the fourth graders and then coming back next year and looking at the next crop of fourth graders and declaring a school either adequate or failing. And so there have been a lot of discussion about it. And connected to that is money, which you mentioned budgetary. Mm-hmm. So I'll put it this way. In this era of really extreme attention to tests, standards, tests, and accountability, what kind of major problems have surfaced over that? And I imagine money's in there somewhere.
Well, that's a big question. I think accountability has done some good things. So you can't really throw out No Child Left Behind completely. I think there are some really good things that happened with that bill and that law. Certainly there have been some problems in the test piece of it, and concentrating so much on that has been a problem for a lot of people. But it has made us look at teacher accountability and come up with a new instrument. In Rhode Island, we have a new teacher evaluation system where, you know, parents really want teachers to be accountable. You can't just say, well, those kids are poor, so they're not going to do well. And it's not the teacher's fault. So to actually, you know, be able to look at teacher performance, I think is really critical and important. And so I think No Child Left Behind sort of got us sort of looking at that and making us think about accountability. And certainly Massachusetts, with its testing, they have, you know, the high school test, which we haven't had in the past. But Rhode Islanders look at Massachusetts and your kids do better. They, for some reason, the reform movement started earlier in Massachusetts than in Rhode Island. And certainly it's been successful in moving kids forward.
What do you say about that, Penny?
I think that we actually have done a really good job in Massachusetts. I don't know that it's necessarily the result of standardized testing, but I think that things such as the Ed Reform Act of 93 and the No Child Left Behind has certainly put the spotlight more on education, and I wonder if maybe that has something to do with it. And the teacher evaluation piece, we also are in the midst of it. In fact, every school that's supposed to be getting Race to the Top money should have their contracts negotiated by now to agree on how the teacher evaluation is going to be done. I know our teachers association is really excited about it. It's a real change in how they'll be evaluated, taking into consideration student achievement. It's pretty interesting, but our teachers in our district are real excited.
I think it's so interesting.
I'm very excited.
Yeah, no, I think it's forced. We had the kneecap in Rhode Island. I don't think you had the kneecap, the New England assessment. And now we're all.
Is that
all,
what New England assessment was called, kneecap?
Yeah, it was called kneecap. It was the way we looked at our kids. And now we're moving to the PARC. Some states have smart balance, but most states are going with the PARC, which is a new way of assessing, with many more interim assessments, so that you are looking, that very question you had about just looking fourth graders 1 year and then a new batch the next year, how does that really? With the new teacher evaluation, you're looking at the same kids. Mm-hmm. You're seeing where they are all through the school year, so multiple assessments.
Looking at growth.
No, you know, I was in education for 30 years in various places, did state projects, was a reading specialist, started the reading first reading labs, and all these kinds of things. I didn't just stay in fourth grade for 30 years. So I know what you're talking about, but it was really shocking to me because we did have, I guess it was just so local, though. We did have an evaluation system in the system I worked with, which was set up with the teachers and the principal. And so I guess this has made it more general and more widespread. And we always looked at growth. We had individual reading tests. We had basal reading tests. We had standardized reading. So when Mr. Bush said, we're going to test kids, we all went, the emperor has no clothes. What do you mean? We're all testing. We're all testing all the time. You know, whatever. So, but anyway, as you said, it put the spotlight on it. It maybe made it more uniform. But boy, I have been in there, and I know how hard teachers work. And to say, oh, most, you know, these teachers, and they're paid so wonderfully well, but, you know. They're not paid well. They're not respected. And the only bad part I see, and I shouldn't be editorializing, but if I could say to the school committees that the people who have been really good, and in Massachusetts especially, they have worked with the teachers' associations, and they have some of the highest scores. Just like Finland, they love to tell us, Finland's so high. They are 100% unionized. So my feeling is to stop beating up on teachers, and good school committees are working, I hope, with the teachers.
Yeah, you know, the difference between Finland and here is that teachers are revered in Finland.
Yes, and respected.
Respected. It's a real honor to be chosen to go to teacher college in Finland, whereas here it's not so much mm-hmm. admired, and I think mm-hmm. that's a real shame. I think teachers work extremely hard. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't be a teacher for anything, and I so admire people that teach, because I have to teach in my job, and I really don't like it.
Yeah, it's very
I'm not good at it.
Long hours, and I've taught from kindergarten through college, and I'm telling you, the people who teach those first three grades, you do, as the Fulgrim book said, everything I ever wanted to learn, I learned in kindergarten. Yep. Right. Those basic learning skills and et cetera.
I mean, I personally don't think you can pay a teacher too much.
I totally
agree
with that.
If they're a good teacher
and they're
successful in the classroom.
Yes.
And I do believe you can build a better teacher. So mm-hmm. We're always looking at, and I think at the race to the top, some of the initiatives to that in Rhode Island especially are the induction of new teachers, mm-hmm. you know, providing mentors for teachers mm-hmm. in a really good way, not just, you know, sort of, oh, how did your day go? But actually mm-hmm. going in and observing yep. and saying, this is what you did, you know,
this is what you could have done better.
You know, 15 minutes into the period, two of the kids in the class didn't seem to be engaged. You know, having those extra eyes in the classroom has been, the things that we've seen about induction so far have been phenomenal.
And
it's really great stuff.
I think it'll keep the really bright kids that went into teaching, like at a good school like here at Bridgewater State, these kids go in, they get a good education, they come out, they're all excited about teaching, and I think we lose an awful lot of them because they're not being mentored, and I think teachers are much like, hello, my profession of nursing, we eat our young, it's not good, it's bad. We don't do a good job of mentoring new people in the profession, and I think it's a real shame.
The other part of that, of course, is not to squelch creativity as we're mentoring them, because that's one of the old problems. They would be put in, a student teacher was put in with a teacher who was just very traditional and ordinary, and she mm-hmm. thought, well, that's working for her, mm-hmm. so now it works for me.
Yeah.
And sometimes schools do not. I happen to be somebody, I worked with a great principal who said, mm-hmm. oh, you want to start a drama club? Let's mm-hmm. schedule that out. Mm-hmm. Oh, you want to start something, a reading lab? Mm-hmm. And when you have a good principal who's not just, did you keep your class's attention today? That one visit? Mm-hmm. You know, it's a whole climate, I think, in a school. So school committees, mm-hmm. I think, I loved what you said earlier, that you set a tone and a vision. Mm-hmm. So when you have that respect, that made me feel very happy to hear that for the teachers. Mm-hmm. And, you know, talking about working with them and not just putting them in there.
Well, there's been a lot of teacher bashing going on, and it's very difficult to be a teacher today. So
it's,
I think school committees really do have to be supportive. Mm-hmm. And I think for the most part we are, and that's why, I mean, there's always that person who's going to be elected that is out for a one agenda item, mm-hmm. Like somehow saying, you know, unions are no good, or mm-hmm. bashing salaries or whatever. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think it's important for those of us who are really longstanding members and have good leadership that we can guide those people. And surprisingly, I've actually had members like that have come on board and then said, wow, I didn't know what you guys did.
Uh-huh.
And you
want to
know
that's
something?
That's why the show.
Exactly. Yes. And so you change them. You change some of their, you know, their opinions.
Mm-hmm. Attitudes,
so that's the positive piece.
I've seen that as well. It's,
it's
kind of interesting.
Well, you know, it's a really a privilege for me. I had read about you, and I had met Katherine before when she was working on PTA mm-hmm. presidency. But thank you so much for taking this time. And we're going to take a break right now. But when we come back, we've been talking about the teachers, and as I mentioned to you earlier, I'd like to focus on the various groups you work with, the superintendent, et cetera.
Sure.
So the teachers we've been talking about, and I'm glad it came up in this order, because they are the real important people in this country. Without education and those teachers going in every day, whoever the school bus mm-hmm. drops off. So I'm very happy that you feel great about teachers. And stay with us. We'll come back and find out more about what your school committee is doing. We'll be right back.
My life, it's full of statistics. Thing is, I could have dropped out of school and become one myself, but I didn't, because I had people that believed in me. Here's another statistic. 7,000 students drop out every school day. That's one every 26 seconds. It's time that students know that we believe in them.
Inspire a student and share your message of support at boostup.org.
Katherine and Penny Blackwell and Katherine Paternaude, you have just been so helpful talking about the teachers. Mm-hmm. Now, there's a fellow that kind of comes into the school and all the teachers go, the superintendent's here. Now, how are you related to the superintendent?
Well, he's our chief executive officer, basically.
You hire him.
We hire him. Yes, we do. We hire him. We evaluate him.
Or her. Yeah.
Or her. Exactly. I'm actually in a vocational technical schools district, so it's just the high school. So our two superintendents are in the school all the time. So it's a little bit different than in a consolidated district where the superintendent may or may not be in the school building from time to time.
So we also fire the superintendent.
Yes. Yes, we do.
I have to put that in only because of the following, not in a negative way at all, but only because so many of our constituents, the parents out in the community, think that we fire teachers and that we hire teachers, and we don't.
And we do not.
We recommend, we approve the recommendation of our chief executive officer, who in fact is the superintendent.
Who hires
the teachers and fires or discontinues any staff member, school related personnel or whatever. So they always think that we're going to somehow be able to get them a job and or fire a teacher that they don't like or whatever, and that's not our role at all.
Not going to happen.
So they have to do
only,
it themselves.
We only hire and ultimately, terminate a superintendent, mm-hmm. our superintendent.
The superintendent then, as a CEO, he does have to look over the whole, you may have six schools or mm-hmm. eight schools in a district mm-hmm. as well. So he has to be aware through the principals
Correct.
Of what's happening. Mm-hmm. And how do you relate to the principals, or do you? Is it only through the superintendent?
Legally, it's really through the superintendent. Certainly at our school, where it's just one school in our district, we have a pretty good relationship with our principal. He comes to all our school committee meetings and gives a principal's report. And that's been happening for probably the last 6 or 7 years. And it's kind of nice because we get a little better idea of what's going on kind of in the trenches than what we get it from the high level view that the superintendent
Excellent.
Gave. Yeah.
But as you can imagine, if you see a constituent, a parent in the supermarket, they're going to come up to you and say many things. They could say, oh, we love our new principal or new teacher or whatever. Mm-hmm. Typically it's positive, but sometimes mm-hmm. it's the negative. And our job really is not to start the gossip mill and start
Correct.
Saying yes, oh, I agree, no. Basically, we can just say, if you have a concern, a complaint, or any kind of problem, have you talked to your childhood's classroom teacher? Mm-hmm. If that didn't work, have you talked to the principal? If that didn't work, did you, in fact, make an appointment to see the superintendent? Because mm-hmm. because school boards and school committees are the final appeal. So if a parent really has a problem that doesn't get rectified in some mm-hmm. way, shape, or form, even at the superintendent's level, then they can appeal to the to the school committee. And you don't want to hear all the ins and outs. You want to hear it for the first time as
from
a school
the
committee.
Superintendent.
That's a really good point.
Exactly.
From
so we basically, mm-hmm. we try to, people will call me all the time, and in this world of email, they will say it all, lay it all out, because they don't know what the proper place is. And I always forward it to the superintendent, and I say, I'm forwarding this to the superintendent. He will look into it, or mm-hmm. she will look into
so
it.
So you shop at your hometown?
Now, wait a minute. Some places, they want the teacher to live right in the community.
Sometimes that happens.
In certain places.
Of course they
so
do,
they want,
yeah.
In fact, there have been some people, Jean, my goodness, her name is gone from me, but the chancellor of UMass Dartmouth mm-hmm. was on the show, and I just loved how she said she loved to be in her community where UMass Dartmouth, and people would come up to her and talk with her. Again, because you do get a greater sense of who your mm-hmm. constituents
oh, for
and
sure.
your families are.
Exactly. That's what's so great about being on a locally elected school committee. I think that you are part of the community that in which you serve. Mm-hmm. Your school committee is kind of the heart and the soul of the community, of the school district.
There are a lot
pretty cool.
In our newspaper, though, we get all the news about who's blocking out so-and-so and who had a private meeting and didn't let so-and-so, and we don't want him on the school committee. But, we're all just people. Mm-hmm. But thank God there are people like you. You sound mm-hmm. so fair and open about things. We've talked a little about the teacher and the superintendent's connection, and actually the parents here. So let's talk a little more about the parents before we talk about city, town, or mm-hmm. legislature. You mentioned how if a parent has a problem mm-hmm. with the child, you usually recommend they go to the teacher first.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And now, but how does a school committee person, if it gets to you, how do you really know? Is it like a series to the principal to explain? I know basically what happens.
If you tell a parent to go up the chain,
that's
then my responsibility would be to go down the chain, starting with the superintendent and going to the superintendent and saying, hey, I don't know if this has gotten to your level, but this parent keeps calling me. Could you please
look into it?
Because
most superintendents
are
very responsive, and they figure it out.
Very much so.
They will go to the first source too.
They'll go to the principal.
They'll go to the principal first, and then if the principal says we can have a meeting with the teacher, we'll, you know, and then if it does come to the school committee level, usually the school committee would get a briefing.
Okay, you know, you'd have a background.
During executive session, which is not open to the public, where you would find out, the principal could be there, even the original teacher who the complaint might have, or whatever has been lodged against them, will be there as well and give their facts as they see it. Mm-hmm. Then they leave the room typically, and then the parent, and usually a student doesn't come in front on their own. Sometimes the student and a parent will come before you and then give their side. And then they leave, and then we make a decision one way or the other on how we feel about
it. A lot depends on having fair-minded, good people. And with the apathy that I sense, I mean, we're the only show in the country about education. Yeah. So I can't help but think that maybe there's a little apathy out there. Mm-hmm. How do you get people to volunteer as you people did to keep the school committees going?
You know, in my town, I was telling Kathy before we started that politics is kind of blood sport in Sandwich, and there's very rarely a shortage of candidates to run for anything. It's kind of crazy. Except this very past election, they had a really hard time getting candidates to run for the school committee for the first time since I've lived there in 17 years.
Yeah, and two of our seats that are up this particular election season are uncontested. We don't have
it's
two people in the race. They're people that are just going to walk back into office. So because I think people are busy, you know, and
working two jobs.
Yeah. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And so it's hard to put that kind of time. It's not just two meetings a month. Mm-hmm. It's so much more than that.
It's so much more than that.
So much more. And when there's negotiations, for example, for a new teacher contract, I mean, I've been, you know, 6 months, 7 months, once, twice a week, sometimes all night long. Yeah. So a lot of folks just really can't.
It's a big commitment.
And then, you know, unfortunately, sometimes people don't understand the work you do, and it can get frustrating when you're criticized.
Why don't you come up with your contract right away?
Well, why didn't you do it this way? Yeah. Because and they haven't really. Sometimes I often say to my committee, I feel like we're making decisions in a vacuum sometimes because not a lot of people show up. Yeah. Not a lot. Unless
you mean the public to watch it?
Yes.
To listen?
Unless it's a hot button issue that everybody seems to be, you know, you change a policy that people finally, when it gets, they actually start living the policy, they go,
uh-oh,
when did that happen and how did that happen? And we don't like it. And so they'll all show up at school committee at that point. But they've missed all that pre-discussion that you've had and all the dialogue. And so that can be frustrating. But again, it's still the public, and I just try to
I mean, our best candidates,
have patience.
I still believe our best candidates come out of the PTAs.
Because they become so involved.
And well, you know,
those are that there's good leadership
involved,
training.
There's good leadership training. They're they're the original advocates. Yep. PTA members are advocates for kids.
That's their big thing.
They're there for the
really
kids.
They really tell you to be a parent leader and an advocate. And that's the last piece that we didn't really talk about is our students.
Well, I'm coming to that, but before
that
you
is,
go to, well, if you want to do students now, but and then we'll help. No, go right ahead, because I am delighted to hear about students. Most of our lives have been dedicated, I mean, not only to my own two sons and my triplet grandkids, but to my youth groups, my camps, my teaching all my life. So, rah-rah, let's talk about when a student has a problem, what happens with the school committee?
Same thing, it's the same process. We try to, you know, try to advocate for, be an advocate for them and try to listen to them. And we actually, in my town, we actually have one meeting a year where we go to, we have the high school students in to talk to us about what the pros and cons, the goods, the bads, the uglies in their school. Same thing with the middle school. We rotate our meetings through our individual schools, and those are the best ones because our students typically come up and present. They do a PowerPoint presentation or they do a science project with us, and that really makes it, all my members always say, that's what makes being on school committee worth it, to watch these,
we do the same thing,
and do wonderful things in front of us that make it all worthwhile, make the work, you know, you just let it all go because you just see these great kids doing great stuff.
Our best superintendent who pushed himself into the ground, but he was that kind of a person that everyone felt they could talk to him.
Yeah.
And so the school committee, the superintendents, as you mentioned, I like the way you put that at the beginning, that you're kind of setting the tone. That means so much because I've worked with, for over those years, 30 years, with various principals and superintendents, and it really makes a huge difference to the community.
I think for students to come to school committee meetings is really awesome training for the future as well, because if they see us governing in a civilized manner, and you know, really, and doing policy work that's really meaningful, and they watch us at work, they'll think, gee, maybe that's something I want to do someday. And I think we're kind of grooming the citizens of the future.
As parents, we're all parents here. As we all know, it's the model we set for our children that makes all the difference. You might not even realize it's happening, but then, you know, as they grow up and become adults, and I hear my daughter echo things, and I just go, wow,
she really did get it.
She really did.
She really was listening.
She volunteered to do the wellness, be in charge of the wellness committee at work, and so she's bringing all these people in and doing all kinds of noontime things, and I'm like, oh, wow. And then she said to me, Mom, why do people sign up for things and then not come?
And you said, I can identify with that.
That's my daughter.
That's hilarious.
It really is, yeah.
So I don't know if we'll have much time, just a minute or two, but speaking about, we have about 1 minute, relating to your legislature, your town, it's so important, your mayor or your school, you know, your whatever situation you have in your town or city.
It's so important to advocate for the schools and not just at budget time. I think it's so important to show up at a selectman meeting every now and again, just to show your face actually so they see you, but or to get up and kind of brag on what's been going on in the schools. I know our school will go and present, or we'll invite our selectmen and finance committees to come up and have dinner one night at the school.
Wow.
The kids cook.
Hope people are listening to this.
And really take them on a tour of the school and show them around. And when a new selectman's elected, either myself or the other representative from Sandwich will bring them up to the school and show them around.
Well, you know,
I don't know if you can say
collaboration. Yes. Collaboration and communication.
And communication.
Absolutely.
Do you feel optimistic or are you frustrated at this point, with so much that you have to deal with, online learning and technology?
I'm always optimistic.
Great. I'm an eternal optimist.
You're always optimistic.
My cup might be half empty, but I'm an eternal optimist.
Mine's half full.
Thank you very much. And I'm so happy to have had you here. And keep
thank
up your good work.
Us.
We really appreciate it. In closing, to maintain that wonderful vision that we have here in America, that public education for all is by the people and for the people, and if that's true, we need to have the school committees keep a central place in our education discussion, which you know I call school talk.